And I reminded, you know, one of the things that comes into my mind when I think of holiness is obviously the example of St. Francis, whose feast we celebrate today. But I want to talk about another Francis for a moment, Pope Francis. And I don't know if you recall, but shortly after he became Pope, before he was installed, so to speak, a reporter asked him, how do you describe yourself as a person? You know, forget this Pope thing for a minute. How do you describe yourself as a person? What can you say about yourself that describes the person that you are? And I don't know if you remember what he said, but he said, well, the one thing I know I can absolutely say about myself as a person that really describes who I am is that I am a sinner. I felt so good when he said that. Now, not because he was a sinner, because I knew that, we knew that, but because he said this, and in so doing, he was actually witnessing to his dependency upon the Lord. Amen. And it's an interesting thing because, you know, in our pastoral ministries, whatever it is we happen to do, we're all involved in the ministry in different ways. We have different ranks, of course. We wear different clothes and things like that. We have different titles. Our people know that we're sinners. They know our faults. And if they don't, or if we don't know that, then we don't know them, and they don't know. They know. People know. People know our weaknesses. People know our strengths and our weaknesses. And what really distinguishes us, if we want to really serve them, is our ability to not only admit that and to know that, but to know our need for the Lord's forgiveness, our need for the Lord's mercy, and to be able to witness to that. Now, why do I say that? Because we're talking about holiness today, and that's basically the theme of the day. And I was thinking to myself, what can I best share about my own growth, my own struggle, my own journey, my own life? I don't want to talk about myself. Those are the worst types of homilies, you know. When I say talking about myself, I mean, I don't want to talk about my last Thanksgiving dinner or my last vacation or anything like that. Some of those things that people are subjected to often, and they become rather narcissistic, I think. You know, it becomes more about father's life, a day from the light. They don't want to hear that. They want to be fed. They want to be fed by what? They want to be fed by our faith journey. And it's precisely in my struggles, as a sinner, experiencing the mercy of the Lord, experiencing the touch of his blessing, that I find I can hopefully be most effective. So if you'll bear with me a little bit, you know, I just tell you a little bit about my background. I was born in Brooklyn. If you can't tell by my accent, it should be rather obvious within a few more sentences too. And I was raised in what would be called an intact family, although interestingly enough, my mother was the child of I guess you could call it a mixed marriage in those days, they did. My grandfather was Jewish, and he came from the Ukraine, and his family migrated, you know, the pogroms of Alexander II, I think it was. And can you all hear me, by the way? Okay. But I was raised in a fairly intact family as a Catholic. So I went to Catholic school. I had the good sisters of Notre Dame, the SNDs, and Belgian community. And I had a very, very good education. So, I grew up in the 50s, having been born in 48, and it was a time in which I suppose you became a Catholic because the people in the neighborhood were. I mean, we had Protestant people, we had Catholic people, we had a few Jewish people. But it was basically something that you kind of took for granted. The culture itself seemed to be supportive of a Christian upbringing. We didn't live in a type of secularized environment like we do nowadays as well, too. So we took a lot of those things for granted. To be a Catholic basically meant to follow the rules. Basically, you know? And religion, although it was a subject, it was something that you kind of learned how to do. You learned the rules, and then you did it. And I have to admit that I grew up feeling that the role of being a holy person was to be good. And to be good meant that you basically. Follow the rules, and if you follow the rules, God would be very happy with you. And if you didn't, God would be ticked. And that was pretty much my understanding of what it meant to be holy. Be good, try hard, and if you try hard, and if you work hard enough, and then, of course, all of the different things, and I went into a minor seminary. When I graduated, I went into cathedral prep. It was a minor seminary. And I began to start learning a little more about the rules of spirituality. And those rules, as I came to learn them, were you had to pray. You had to pray every day. And we had very good formation in that regard. We were told, you know, start learning how to meditate, maybe 15 minutes, and then if you can get a little faster than that, a little longer than that, extend it beyond that to an hour. And as I went through my seminary years, you know, as many of you yourself, was exposed to all of the different schools of spirituality, Jesuit spirituality, Theresian, Big Teresa, Little Teresa, and so forth, and Franciscan spiritual, and they were all very, very wonderful, kind of like a smorgasbord, you know, take a little bit of this, take a little bit of that, and see whichever applied to you. And by the way, I say that with great respect because I still do that. You know, I cannot honestly say that I follow one particular school of spirituality. You know, St. Ignatius, certainly the reflective, particular examine, great value to, you know, as St. Ignatius said, an unreflective life is not a life worth living. And the importance of understanding by reviewing our day, all very, very important. But none of them really were making me holy. As a matter of fact, I would have to say that going into the early days of my priesthood, I was ordained at the age of 25, happened to be fortunate to study in North American College. I was ordained, by the way, at the chair of Charles the Bald. I don't know if you know that. The chair behind the, they found out by carbon sampling that gold chair behind the main altar in St. Peter's actually contains the chair of Charles the Bald. So, you know, a little bit of a come down in thinking that it was Peter's chair, but what the heck? What the heck? I've always been reminded of my Brooklyn roots, however. My grandfather used to cut my hair, you know, and he was the one that, as he was cutting our hair at the age when I was 13, 14 years of age, he always had this thing about people that wore a uniform and felt they were better than anybody else, you know. And he used to say to me, you know, remember, the Pope has to put his pants on in the morning just like everybody else, one leg at a time. So I think from my very early age, I was probably reminded of the fact that, you know, true spirituality really is grounded in humility, in openness to the Lord. And it's not so much about what we're doing to please God or to gain points, so to speak, on that spiritual scale, but how much more open are we to God's presence in our lives? How much more trusting am I in God's work? And unfortunately, unfortunately at first, it turned out to be actually a blessing, but unfortunately at first, and I'm getting to a point because I had kind of a conversion experience. It wasn't a big deal. I didn't see any flashing lights or anything, but it was a big deal for me, at least. Much of my early life, my priesthood, I do remember struggling at first with preaching, but the problem was the struggle I had with preaching was really because I was trying to force myself into a method of preaching. In other words, I was trying to write it out and get the 3 points, and I do try to make usually 3 points, and I was told, you know, do it in 7 minutes, otherwise it's too much. I'm not going to talk just for 7 minutes, but but I do remember a very specific experience where God got my attention. And it was after I was ordained, early part of my priesthood, I came home to my home parish to say my first Mass of Thanksgiving, Our Lady of the Miraculous Medal in Ridgewood. And I'm struggling, you know, writing down on the yellow paper my 3 points and trying to organize it, and I wasn't going to memorize it. But I remember getting up into the pulpit at that Mass, addressing the people who were who had known me from my childhood, and I started to preach, and I lost my place. And what I realized was that it was a good thing, because what I had missed was the eye contact, and I went with the eye contact, and I just kept talking. You know, and as it turns out, I ended up probably saying about 30% of what I had planned to say, but other things started to come in to my mind, because you begin to start realizing that, and this I have found to be true throughout my experience of preaching as a priest, you know, throughout my life, is that it's almost like there's something that when you preach, that yes, you do your preparation, you do your praying, and you do your research, and you do your scriptural exegesis and all of that, and you do your organization. But then there's something unique about every congregation that you can't predict. You've had that experience, I'm sure. You may plan to say something, and then you look at the people, and you say, no, that doesn't fit the mood, you know? And you become to realize that this whole preaching thing is really very sacramental. It's something that happens in the personality and experience of the one preaching, something that's in the congregation, their need, their hunger, their desire, what they're hearing, and something the Holy Spirit does in between. I mean, a lot the Holy Spirit does in between. Because I'm going to say things that I'm not saying, and you're going to hear things that it is a trust that somehow or other that God's Spirit is working in this. And if the folks want to hear it, they will hear it. God will find a way of doing that. I've come to recognize that, you know. But my kind of conversion experience didn't really happen until I was in my 30s. And being a person who had been, you know, academically, I like school, I'll admit it. You know, I have, and I've always figured a good thing to do as a priest is to keep studying, keep learning more, and that's a good thing to do. And I actually did something. I was working at the tribunal at the time, and I decided to put myself through law school, you know, civil, and I was interested maybe working with people who were immigrants and helping. I like constitutional law, First Amendment issues, you name it. And I thought it would be a good thing to do because I had kind of a day job. I was living in a parish, ministering on weekends, but my tribunal work was kind of 9 to 5. So I figured, well, what am I going to do with the rest of my day? Don't call me a workaholic. I don't consider that. You know, I really don't think so. But anyway, what am I going to do with my nights? So I went to Fordham Law School. And, you know, if you've seen The Paper Chase or anything like that, you know the first year of law school is hell. And they try to break you down and get you to leave after you've paid your tuition. But the, but anyway, I was going, and I was having a rough time of it, you know, balancing. And I remember at one time saying to myself, why the heck am I doing this? I actually said something else, but I can't say it on the tape. And it so happened that there was a priest who was present in the rectory that I was living in, who did actually happen to have studied spiritual theology, and we developed a friendship, and he was very kindly. And I remember sitting at the kitchen table, you know, after I had thrown a couple books around the room up because it was a bad weekend, and I said, why do we even bother to do this? Why am I even doing this? What is this all for? And he said to me, well, because God loves you. Now, the nun had said that before, you know, I had known that. But it actually hit me for the first, God loves us. God loves us. God. I remember one of the nuns had told us, you know, Jesus would have died for you if you were the only person in the world. And maybe I said that in homilies, you know, but it sort of like went into my head and out of my mouth, but it didn't come through my heart. Something about the way Father Jim Reynolds witnessed to me, that was his name, he's still alive, not in good health. The way he said that, said it with such conviction that it just touched my heart, that God loves me. Now, you may say, maybe you won't say, maybe you will say, well, yeah, duh. You know, isn't that the whole basis of the Christian faith? Well, I go back to the catechism. You know, we had the Baltimore Catechism in those days. And I remember, you know, one of the very first questions in the catechism was, why did God make you? God made us to show forth his goodness and so that we'd be happy with him in heaven. Why are we on this earth? God, to know, love, and serve him in this world. Remember that one? And to be happy with him in heaven. Know, love, and serve. Now, I think I understood something about the know part, although none of us can ever completely know God, but know the knowledge thing, you know, faith as being something that, you know, that we... It gives us knowledge of God, revealed history, and so forth. Knowledge of ourselves, what we are as human beings. The knowledge part I got, and I continue to, you know, theology, faith seeking understanding. But you see, it presumes faith. And, you know, you can teach a parrot theology, But it doesn't necessarily mean that the parrot is converted, you know? And and I think, you know, and sometimes people say that about us too. Gee, he sounds just like a parrot, you know? And we heard this before. And you know the difference, you know the difference when you're hearing a homily. One of the things that fortunately as a regular preacher I'm not exposed to is what the poor people are often exposed to. And every once in a while when I'm on vacation, you know, if I'm traveling in the United States, I like to go surreptitiously into churches and just hear what the poor folks have to put up with every day, you know? And I don't mean to, you know, I don't mean to put the good intentions down. But the reality is that it was a head thing for me, you know? Religion was a subject, and I would have been probably miffed if somebody said, you know, that's my view, but I don't think I really, to serve God. Well, now there's an interesting thing too. It is indeed a good thing to do good works, a good thing to do good works, and it's a good thing to feel good about doing good works. And many of us do that, and certainly we're constantly being called to do works of charity and so forth. But you know, there's a point in which we can end up getting very self-congratulatory. I can't tell you how many banquets I go to, you know, $100, $200 a plate sometime around the diocese, with a lot of good people doing good works, doing nothing but congratulating themselves on the back about all the good works they do, you know? And that is a good thing. Of course that needs to be. But is that really what our faith is about? Is it just about our knowledge? Is it just about the good things that we do with the help of God's grace? Is it about the good people that we are? Of course we're good. God, we're fundamentally good. You know, God, don't make junk, like they always said, you know? But the reality is that none of those really touched the heart. And then I began to wonder, am I the only person that really is missing the whole point of what the faith is all about? I'm in my 30s now, and I'm saying I'm finally beginning to see it has something to do with God's love for me personally, and my love for God. And then I began to think, maybe I'm not the only person that has this struggle, trying to really believe of God's personal love for me. And it began, as my life has unfolded, I began to realize that, you know, all of the saints have struggled with this as well, too. The difference is that what they seem to learn, maybe sooner rather than later, is that finally it all boils down, obviously, to love, to a matter of trust. Of trust, and trust in God. And letting Jesus be who he really is. Not just a nice guy, not just a teacher, you know, not the lawgiver exclusively, although he's all of that. I have to say that the writings of C.S. Lewis have had a profound influence on me in that, because he always makes that point. You know, who do you really say, who really is Jesus? You know, who really is? Do we let him be the God that he really is, the God-man that he really is? Do we let him really be the center of our lives? And I've reflected upon this a lot, too, and, you know, and I don't want to pick on any particular saint. Saint Augustine is an easy one to pick on because he has such an obvious transformation. But let me pick on Peter, okay? I'll use Peter as an example. And as I began to reflect upon Peter's own life, and this is just my own personal reflection, and I hope he forgives me for this. I hope you forgive me for this. But I kind of think that Peter was not really converted, if at all, until after the resurrection of Jesus. You know, and I'm basing that on the scriptural evidence. You know, you look at the first one, he's called to be the king of the apostles, and boy, he loves that, doesn't he? You know, king of the apostles, and Jesus makes this in profound statement, particularly in Matthew, as you know, and then no sooner does he put Peter in charge of the other apostles, make him sort of the king of the apostles, when Jesus says, yes, but now the Son of Man is going to have to suffer and so forth, and die, and the third day rise again. And immediately Peter, because he knows it all now, starts to lecture Jesus about, you know, the way he should be running his ministry. And he's, oh, God forbid anything like that. Well, you know, God be reasonable, see it my way. You know, how often have we been tempted to do that at times? You know, we see our prayers as sort of persuading God to kind of see things reasonably, see it our way, and then we treat, as C.S. Lewis would say, we end up treating God as a buddy or as an ally, you know, but we actually are the the ones in charge. And Jesus is the one that's sort of like following our plan instead of being willing to do it the other way. And so, of course, naturally, we know what happens. Jesus takes Peter aside and says, you know, get behind me, Satan. You know, so, but what a come down. You know, no sooner is he lifted up when he's pulled down. Why? Because he wants to humiliate Peter? It doesn't seem that way because it's not public. You know, it's not a public shaming. But he's actually bringing Peter to his level, you know? And trying to teach Peter that really to love as he loves is to love as the servant. And of course, we could go on, but the next incident that comes to mind, a profound incident in the life of Peter, is St. John's account of the washing, you know, of the disciples' feet the night before he dies. And Jesus, using that example in almost a Eucharistic way, really, says to, you know, goes around washing their feet. And Peter says, you know, you're not going to wash my feet, Lord. Why is he saying that? Now, maybe Peter thought that this was beneath Jesus' dignity. Maybe he doesn't seem to have gotten that the whole point of Jesus' life was going to be that he would have to pour out his life. You know, that this is really why Jesus came, to suffer and to die. And maybe he was still influenced by the Jewish theology. I don't know, a different type of messiahship than what Jesus knew he was to be. And of course, what really got to Peter is when Jesus says to Peter, well, if you don't let me wash your feet, you can have no part of me. Now see, Peter seems to have thought that he was a good friend of Jesus. If nothing else, Jesus liked him as a friend, and he liked Jesus as a friend. And the thought of losing Jesus' friendship, that got to Peter. So maybe he understood that much, you know, that there is a some sort of a friendship between him and Jesus. And he let Jesus go through the motions. And of course, we know what happened later on that night when he betrays his best friend, you know. Interesting that Peter and Judas, I don't know how far the comparison could go, but they both betrayed Jesus in different ways, right? Whether you can say they committed the same sin, I don't know. And we know what Judas did. Judas gave up. Judas lost hope. We don't know where Peter was. We know he wasn't around the cross. We're told he wept bitterly in an alley. Who wouldn't after that? You betray your best friend who you had proclaimed and had the inspiration to believe he was the Messiah, and now you... He didn't realize at that point that he was cooperating in some way in the plan, because this was part of his education, to recognize his sinfulness. Jesus was teaching him that to be a disciple of mine is to recognize your sinfulness, your brokenness. And only when you realize that sinfulness and brokenness can I really help you, because only then can I be your Savior. If you're already saved, if you're already God, if you already know all the answers, you know, if you know all your catechesis, but you're not evangelized, because he wasn't evangelized yet, because he hadn't really accepted Jesus for who Jesus was, you know. And I don't want to get too theological. I was really trying not to, because I do think one of our biggest problems today is that we're great in catechesis, but we're not evangelized. You know, I'm not telling you anything you don't know. You know, we can say a lot about Jesus. We can talk a lot about Jesus. We can preach a lot about Jesus, but do we believe Jesus? You know, and I turn this right on myself. You know, whenever you point any finger at the other three, point right back to you. So I'm sharing you my own struggle in coming to recognize that who Jesus really is, you know, that he really is my personal Savior. You know, that's not a terribly Catholic thing, by the way, but it's in our Catholic, you know. I mean, I envy many times, you know, sometimes maybe you've had this experience. I sit in planes, you know, and you hear a young fellow, maybe it's a Jehovah's Witness, maybe it's a Mormon, maybe it's somebody, an evangelical, you know. And I remember one day I'm sitting in the plane leaving Albany, and I hear this young fellow, he couldn't have been over 21, and he's sitting next to, I think, who was a professional person, you know, and he gets out of the man very quickly that the professional guy is a Catholic, and he says to him, oh, you're Catholic, huh? Are you saved? He says to him right away, you know, and I said, oh, he's going to get him right there, because you know what the Catholic's going to say? Well, I hope so. I'm trying, you know, and then he's going to lead him right to John 1, I think 1:23, that says, well, if you profess you really believe in Jesus, you are saved, you know, and but anyway, but back to back to Peter. I feel more comfortable picking on him. Back to Peter again. And so Peter weeps. But fortunately, by the grace of God, he doesn't go and hang himself. He doesn't give it all up. Something must have convinced him. And he didn't really know at that point. I mean, even though Jesus had been saying again and again and again and again, you know, I'm going to die, but the Son of Man will die, but on the third day will rise again. They thought it was pretty much over. So, but something, Peter held on in some way. And then, of course, you know how the story develops, the empty tomb, and Jesus appears to them. There he is at the side of the Sea of Galilee, and they're cooking fish, and there they are around this brazier there. And I guess the analogy couldn't have been lost, because Peter had just betrayed Jesus around a fire as well, too, you know, that you, right? And what does Jesus do but ask him three times, Simon Peter, do you love me? He poses the key question, the only question, really, for us, do you love me? That's really the only real question Jesus has for any of us, do you love me? Do you love me? And then feed my lambs, feed my sheep. He asks him three times, just like the three denials. And then Peter is able to say, yes, Lord, you know I love you. He's almost annoyed the third time he says it. You know, of course, Lord, you know everything. You know I love you. Feed my lambs, feed my sheep. And of course, he gives Peter essentially the Great Commission. Go and tell the gospel. Feed my lambs, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. How do I kind of like put this in a little bit of a structure? What I have come to realize in terms of my own, you know, desire to be holy is, number one, the more I recognize my brokenness and my sinfulness, the better it is. And it helps me to be grateful, even though I'm not grateful, but to be at least in a willed sense, not in an emotional sense, to be grateful for those who point out my faults and weaknesses. And whether that's a nasty letter I get, or a letter that I think is a nasty letter, for all I know, it could be coming from an angel that is instructing me, and God is using the other person. But that the more I am aware of my brokenness. See, now, of course, being a bishop, you know, a cleric, and also a male, your first reaction anytime something is broken is you want to fix it. You know, it's my job to fix it. You know, and that's not always the reason people complain. Sometimes they don't want it to be fixed. They want to be listened to. Right? And recognizing that, first of all, I'm not going to fix it anyway, you know, that I have to turn to the Lord. This is an invitation to dig in to Jesus, you know, and to see how we can maybe work by building a relationship and letting the Lord's Spirit decide how we're going to work this through. But I have come to recognize that, number one, to be holy is not to be good, but to be a sinner who turns over to the Lord and trusts in the Lord. That's one of the first things I'm coming to discover. That holiness is much more about not my perfection or being perfected, but it has much more to do with my honest awareness of my brokenness, my sinfulness, my need for the Lord, and the way in which the Lord is also coming to show his love through the community itself, through others, through the least, you know, through others. Sometimes other broken people, you know. And how many times we've experienced this ourselves, you know. Even to help people that are broken or in need, whether that's drugs, whether that's psychological illness, emotional illness, physical illness, you know, it is their brokenness that brings out of us the ability to be able to bring the presence of God's love, you know. That they are the ones really, you know, we're not so much the servants so much as we're being served by those who draw out of us our ministerial acts. So the second thing, of course, is the obvious. You got to pray, you know. And I knew all that, learned all that and so forth, but I become more convinced, you know, who was it who said, I've heard this said, if maybe you can, I haven't found the answer on the web, But I've heard it said that prayer is not in time, time is in prayer. Did you ever hear that? Prayer is not in time, time is in prayer. Of course, that's very theological. Who is the prayer par excellence but Jesus himself? That's our Trinitarian rhythm, right? To the Father, with the Son, and the Spirit. And Jesus is the one, you know, when we celebrate Mass, the priest has no face. They say, we're uniting with Jesus, who is always lifting us up. You know, we're caught up in this eternal praise of God, you know, that Jesus was always doing. We see constantly, Jesus was constantly praying, right? I give God thanks, you know, constantly. The Our Father, the prayer, you know, it's the motion to the Father. Jesus is the prayer that's always calling us in. So when we pray, you know, I've come to see prayer, as I know many of you, if not most of you have, you know, over the years, is that it's not so much about words that we say to God, but so much our letting God lift us up and drawing us into God's own life. You know, it's, I guess one way of looking at it, it's a process of allowing God to detox us every day. You know, to detox us of what? Our idols, our distractions, our patterns that give us a sense of false security, but don't really bring that security. You know, talk about workaholism, you know, which is common enough among good people that's to serve the Lord. You know, we've got our schedules and we become sometimes victims of it. And people around us see that. We become robotized at times, you know. And we need to be detoxed of some of those patterns at times. And sometimes maybe Jesus himself allowed his distractions to be his attractions, if you want to be a little flip about it. How many times he wanted to even go and do something when, you know, he was distracted to meet somebody else's needs. So recognizing again that prayer is something that will happen in us if we let Jesus do it in us. You know, and that's not anything, I'm not knocking good discipline in prayer. There are definitely, you know, just to get ourselves detoxed, sometimes we have to turn the cell phone off, you know, because otherwise, you know, do you ever try to pray with your cell phone on, you know? I remember one time I was beginning Mass and I was saying, oh, might I ask, you know, if anybody has their cell phone, or would you just put it in silent mode, please? And immediately my phone went off, you know? Like E.T., you know, the heart started, you know. But those patterns, you know, it's hard to pray with the television on, with these distractions. And, you know, sometimes the phone even, you know, for older folks, you know, who still have landlines, you know. That's some of us. But, you know, to take that time. And what are we really doing when we pray, but really giving God permission to lift us up and to look at what we need to look at? And of course that takes time, but it's the sacrifice of time to let God come in. What I have come to recognize more recently, so yes, I have to pray. If I don't pray, I fall apart. That's a fact. You know, I just do. I get cranky, I get short, I blow things out of perspective, you know, it just lose the whole perspective. And why is that happening? Because when I'm not praying, I'm not letting God into my life. I'm just basically spinning on an automatic pilot. And you can do that for a while. You can do that for 10 or 20 years, you know. You know, and be very good at it. And be very good at it, you know. And here's the funny thing, you know, God is so patient. You know, God lets us do that a little bit. You know, I guess it's sort of like a parent that picks up a toddler, you know, and the toddler is, you know, flying around like that and thinks that they're flying, and then the parent puts them down and then they cry, but they think they're in charge, you know? And sometimes our talents, our intellect, our theology, our issues, if we feel good, you know, we can confuse that for being spiritually well, and that's not always the case, you know? And our health of the whole person involves, obviously, that spiritual health as well. But prayer, the essentialness of prayer, how else are we going to give God permission to enter our lives? The third thing that I've come to discover, and again, maybe I'm preaching, saying something that is so obvious that, you know, but to me it was a big discovery, is I have to share the good news every day. Now I have to. I can't let a day go by without in somehow evangelizing. Now, that's a funny word, like love, and I'm not going to try to define it all, but what I understand it as is primarily bearing witness to the good news of the transforming power of God's loving grace in me. You know, where I have felt God's mercy. I think the way I most feel God's mercy these days is in God's incredible patience. You know, I think of all the time I wasted or have wasted. And as you get older, I think that bothers you a little bit more because you realize you may have fewer years. Even though none of us knows whether we have one more hour, you know, but I mean, it becomes more obvious because you start noticing things in your body that remind you. But the things that, you know, how patient God is and how God uses everything. But I just have to do that. And I go back to Pope Francis, who always talks about this. And I think in a Franciscan mode, you know, Francis was said to have said, and they probably didn't, but it's certainly in the Franciscan spirit, you know, preach always, use words if necessary. Whether he said it or not, it's certainly the Franciscan spirit. That it's not something, Pope Francis has said, you know, that evangelizing doesn't mean taking a Bible and beating somebody over the head with it. You know, none of us really likes that proselytizing. And how effective really is it, you know? Telling people they're bad, telling people they're going to go to hell if they don't do this thing. You know, that really doesn't work because, again, that's all up here. That's words, you know? But when we share our stories of faith and we'll share our struggles of faith, you know, that's very powerful, you know? And some of you who have had exposure to 12-step programs, you know, you hear those stories so often and how powerful those stories are to have experienced our brokenness and then to seen God's mercy, sometimes through the forgiveness of another person, you know? And the power we have to forgive is unbelievable, you know? And I don't know if you've ever had that experience of, you know, a feeling that you were being judged and then being forgiven of that. It's a powerful experience. So anyway, sin awareness, prayer, and telling the good news in some way. And for myself, I find that I cannot let a day go by without some way consciously doing that. And that doesn't necessarily mean that I'm the one that does the telling of the good news. It might mean listening to somebody else's story of faith that I need to hear, that edifies me. And the more I have discovered that, the more wonderful homilies I've been getting from people I meet day in and day out. Like I could sit down at an appointment with somebody that might be talking about finances or something that has nothing to do with church. Well, it does have to do with church, but I mean, it's not, you know, spiritual. But sometimes stories will just emerge. You know, somebody will, you just ask, you know, how's things going in the family, you know, and almost all, you know, when you go beyond hello, how's everything, how's the weather, you know, very nice, where have you been, where are you going, what did you eat last night, where are you eating tonight? When you get beyond that and say something like, how's things going at home, you know, 9 out of 10 times, somebody's going to say, geez, I don't know. You know, that daughter of mine, you know, she's in college, but we haven't been, I keep sending her money, but she never writes. Or my wife isn't doing so well. She's been sick and so forth and so on. You know, almost always, you know, conversations around the water fountain, almost always some struggle is going to come out of the person that we're with. We all have that. You know, we all have someone right now who we're worried about, someone who we're concerned about, we haven't heard from, they said something, we said something, something didn't happen that was supposed to have happened. So, you know, something is there, and we want to pray. You know, we're praying maybe for that person now even, and we want to say the right thing and do the right thing. And if we give one another sort of permission to open up a little bit about that, how much we can be really sharers of that good news in one another's life. I don't think anybody would object to, you know, if you're in a conversation and a need surfaces, whether it's health, whatever, I don't think anybody would object to if I, you know, you or I said, do you mind if I pray for that person? You know, can we maybe pray together, ask the Lord a little, you know, you don't have to be Christian to do that. You know, it could be I don't think even atheists mind prayer if it's going to do them some good, you know? And what does it mean to be an atheist? They just haven't found the right God yet, you know? probably. They say there's no atheist on a sinking ship, you know? And, you know, we sometimes, we have different views of God that get in the way. But that's basically where I'm coming from, you know, quite frankly. And, but I have to say you know, I find every day to be just so full of opportunity because of that, because you can never pray enough. There's no situation, no person, no conflict, no anxiety that can't be wrapped in prayer, that can't be put before the Lord. And as I say, it's finally a matter of trust. And I'm gonna close on this. This is connected. I'll make the connection. May not seem obvious at first, but you know we're in a year of mercy right now, right? But that's one of the things that we're going with. Pope Francis has invited us to open up the doors, you know, and many churches, you know, have opened up a specific mercy door. Even at St. Peter's, I had the good fortune of walking through the mercy door at St. Peter's. It's on the right, far right side. Well, I have to tell you something. As soon as the Pope announced that he was going to proclaim this year of mercy, I said, oh, that's a wonderful idea. But what a horrible thing it's going to be when he has to close the doors of mercy. That how is that going to play out? It's just a horrible image, you know? And sure, you know, I'm going to close the cathedral door of mercy on November the 13th, and he's going to do it in St. Peter's on the 20th. What is he going to say? You know? And I'm praying for him. But I got a little inspiration, you know? Some of you are familiar with these various consecrations to the Immaculate Heart of Mary, consecration of Divine Mercy, Father Michael Gately. And I said, you know, wouldn't it be wonderful if, as we close the, you know, the symbolic doors, if we allow the Lord to open up the doors of our hearts so that we become the doors of mercy, God's mercy streaming through us, you know? So I'm going to... There are different ways of doing this. Father Gately has this book out, 33 Days to Divine Mercy, and it's a wonderful book. But what it does is basically attracts the spirituality of the little flower, St. Thérèse de Lisieux. And talk about a person who really completely trusted because she felt she had no choice. She grew up, as you know, in a very Jansenistic environment where everything's a sin, everything's a sin, everything's a sin, you're going to go to hell, you know. She grew up in that environment. Her parents were very good people, but they were a little scroopy, you know, and you know, I don't, not to be judgmental, but that was going on at that time, you know. And many Catholics, and I'm sure others, you know, traditions have felt this. So she grew up with a deep sense of her unworthiness, of her smallness, of her nothingness. And, you know, if you didn't see it in the context of this Jansenism, it might have seemed like a little overkill. But she was really sincere about this. And the problem that she had, though, you know, was that she had this incredible passion to be like Big Teresa, you know, Teresa of Avila. She said, I feel like I have the heart of an eagle. You know, I would love to soar with these great saints. She said, I just can't do this. I'm just this little tiny little bird. And I can't do it. She says, but I know it's going to happen. You know what? God, you have to do it for me because I can't do it on myself. Now, this was not, she was not preaching quietism or anything like that. She said, I'm going to struggle. I'm going to take this little path. I'm going to stick to my everyday chores. I'm going to be like this little bird. I'm going to climb up the stairs. And God, I know you're going to pick me up because I know you love me and I can trust you. Because if I can't trust you, I can't do it. And it was her trust. Her entrustment, you know, that's the way I like to think of this Divine Mercy consecration, like Pope John Paul II uses the same expression, more like an entrustment, letting God be God, letting God lift us up. Now, she took it to extremes. She actually said, you know what, I want to be a saint, and I want to be so holy, I don't even want to go to purgatory. You've heard of that, haven't you? You know, I don't even want to go to purgatory. And she went and she apparently told one of the nuns in the convent that she wants to go straight to heaven. And she completely trusts that if she really wants to do it, God's going to make this happen. And the nun told her, she said, oh, you're too proud. How can you possibly assume that? She said, I don't know about you, but I know I'm going to go to purgatory. I'll be very happy to get to purgatory because at least I know that way I'll eventually get to heaven. But The nun thought she was very proud. Well, the nun died, and Therese says that she had a sense that the nun, you know, approached her. I don't know if it was a dream or an actual vision. And she said, the nun did approach her and said, Therese, you were right. I'm in purgatory right now, and if I had had the trust that you have, I would have probably gone straight to heaven too, but I'm just getting what I thought I deserved. And now God says, okay, if you think you deserve it, fine, I'll go along with your plan. But God may actually have greater plans for us. You know, and you or I may think you're the worst sinner in the world. You know, I like to say this sometimes. Sometimes I'll start a homily if I'm doing a confirmation. I say, would the worst sinner in this church please stand up? You know, of course I'm the one standing. You know, I can always get by with that. And you know, one time a lady actually did stand up, down in a lady of Knock, and the whole congregation started to stand up. So I said, well, cut it out. Sit down now. I said, but I do say this in all sincerity. If you feel that you're the worst sinner, you know, like anything that we've been reflecting upon here, you feel you're the worst sinner. Well, that's all well and good, Bishop, you know, but, you know, if you knew kind of the struggles that I've been dealing with and this, that, and the other thing, you know, that's nice for you to say, but, you know, I hope you hear this, you know. And to go right back to one of the first things I learned from Sister Ellen John in 1B, you know, Jesus would have died for you if you're the only person in the world. Believe that. Believe you are loved. Believe you are loved so much. And it's not about you or me being perfect or being sin-free or being, you know, having breathing the air of the saints. Consider the humble example of Thérèse de Lisieux and entrust your heart to the Lord. Just entrust it. And that's really, when you look at most of the saints, what does it really boil down to? Trusting that God loves us, trusting Jesus is who he says he is, and letting the Holy Spirit let it happen. So, you know, unless you become like little children, you know, you can't get through that little door. And what is it like that most we envy in children, really envy as we get older? Their innocence, their trust, their childlikeness, their willingness to... They don't have any issues yet, you know? They don't have any grudges yet. They don't have any bad memories yet, you know, any scars. They just trust, you know? The world is mud-luscious and puddle-wonderful, you know, you know, Jerry Manley Hopkins said, if we could develop that trust of the child, you know, and we see that in the lives of our greatest saints, and there's no reason you or I are not called to be the same. God bless you.
Praise God.